It's time for Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness, powered by the staff at Race Chaser Online. Today's racing news, yesterday's racing history, and now here are your hosts, Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
Good evening, race fans across the globe, and welcome to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. And, you know, as the name suggests, it's time for 2 hours of conversation about everything from across the motorsports spectrum, two wheels to four, dirt, pavement, straight liners, oval track, road course, you name it, we're probably going to hit on it here over the next 2 hours. And well, we get a little crazy while we're doing it, and that is just how this show is. So we hope you hang on and join us for the ride. I'm Jacob Seelman, alongside my RaceChaserOnline.com colleagues, senior editor Tom Baker, Northeast correspondent Kyle Magda. And if the last hour is any indication, gentlemen, this is going to be an insane show. Tom Baker, I'll start with you with a breaking news story that immediately becomes, in my opinion, the top story of the day. Out of the NASCAR Xfinity Series, Elliott Sadler is rumored to be on the move again. A report surfaced about 45 minutes ago that Sadler will be leaving Roush Fenway Racing at the end of 2015, taking One Main Financial and going, wait for it, to Junior Motorsports, Tom, for the 2016 season. Are you buying or selling this latest move?
Well, I'm selling this move, although I'm buying the fact that that's about the only team he has yet to race for. He's been everywhere else. Well, you know what? It's okay. It's probably a good move for Junior Motorsports, but the interesting thing for me with this is this an addition or is somebody getting subtracted? Because we have Regan Smith over there in the 7 car. We have Chase Elliott in the 9 car. Now, we know Chase is going Sprint Cup racing, but
One would assume that Chase is going Cup racing and that seat will be open for 2016.
Which means that nobody would step into that ride and Elliott Sadler would take over that car with One Main Financial. Is that what you're hinting you think may be happening?
That's kind of what I'm getting the feel for right now. And like I said, this is literally fresh off the wire. I only got wind of it about 45 minutes ago. But that's what everybody seems to feel is getting ready to happen. And Junior Motorsports has been very mum about this ever since the report came out from Lee Spencer at motorsport.com earlier this afternoon. And they don't want to say anything yet, but, you know, nobody's denying anything either, which is usually in the NASCAR garage a pretty good sign that, hey, we figured something out before you guys are ready to say it.
Yeah, no, but that's how Jayski got so big. If nobody's denying it, it's probably true. That's interesting, Jake. I'm not sure what to think of that. Elliott's a guy. I mean, he's, you know, there's that old song that Johnny Cash did. I've been everywhere, man. And he names off, you know, a million and one cities.
And actually, Elliott, Hank Snow wrote it.
Well, Johnny Cash sang it. That's the version of it. But anyways, it's have sponsor will travel. And if you have somebody like One Main Financial, then you're always going to have an opportunity. The interesting thing for me is Roush Fenway appears to be, albeit slowly, getting their act together when it comes to the Xfinity stuff. You know, Elliott was with Joe Gibbs, then went to Roush Fenway this year. Even the fact that he had a sponsor didn't save him at Joe Gibbs. He went over to Roush Fenway. Has performed about like he's performed everywhere else.
He was at Richard Childress before that.
And performed about like he's performed everywhere else.
No, because twice he finished as the runner-up to Ricky Stenhouse in the points. So I would argue his best years of late were at RCR.
Well, yeah, but again, if you just look at the performance as a whole and take his body of work as a whole, he never quite gets there. He almost gets there. He runs up front sometimes. He doesn't run up front sometimes. He makes some mistakes sometimes. I just don't necessarily see – I don't see this making any difference whatsoever. Elliott's going to probably win a couple races over there. But you know what? Nobody at Junior has won a race yet this year, have they? I mean –
Well, besides the Cup guys anyways.
Well, yeah, but that's – I guess that's kind of my point is I think the current climate in Xfinity – is that it's mostly about the 22, the 54, and, you know, and the Cup guys.
The 88.
You know, the 88, the 5, whoever, whatever car Kevin Harvick's driving at the moment. You know, it just seems to be a difference. So this is interesting news, and if you were saying, is this something or is this nothing, I would argue it's something, but I don't really know what to think. I don't see this for Junior Motorsports. It's a great opportunity with a solid driver and a solid sponsor. For Elliott Sadler, I don't know that it's a great step up. I just think it's, and I would be interested to know what the background is on that, because you would have thought that Roush would have fought to keep him. So I wonder what to think about that when you have a guy with a full season sponsor that, it 2 years in succession has walked and then walked. He's running out of places to walk to.
He is running out of places to walk to, but I think he's also maybe starting to run down to the end of his timeline in the sport, in my opinion. I guess we'll just wait and see how it goes. But Kyle Magda, I will throw you the other bone that I've been chewing on for the last hour, and this one surfaced on Twitter late last night on the plane ride home from Pocono, and I just happened to pick up on it. Clint Bowyer was doing a little fan question and answer session last night on the plane ride home.
I saw this.
And, well, he dropped an interesting little hint that kind of throws a wrench into all the silly season thoughts that we were starting to think during last week's shows. He got asked by someone if he was on the plane with a old or future teammate, perhaps. And Clint Bowyer responds very quickly, maybe, at Martin Truex Jr. Are you buying or selling that hint could potentially drop Clint Bowyer all of a sudden, not only staying with Toyota, but going to Furniture Row in 2016?
It'd kind of be like a reunion there, you know, with Michael Waltrip Racing, you know, back in the 2013. So it's a possibility. But, yeah, I didn't even know about that, so you just mentioned it. You know, I kind of got Poconoed out.
I've been everywhere and nowhere today. Come on.
Yeah. But, you know, it's an interesting thought you bring it up, you know, and we talk about that. You know, we talked a lot last week about whether, you know, Furniture Row and Michael Waltrip can merge, you know, with that, with Rob Kaufman buying a stake in Chip Ganassi Racing. So there's still a lot of questions out there, but – you know, you do bring up a good point. Also with Junior Motorsports, I just want to comment on that quick. You know, whether they're going to expand it to a fourth car maybe. Maybe have Ben Rhodes and Alpha Energy Solutions step up, go full-time next year. So there's still a lot of questions out there with things, Tom. And really, especially with Clint Bowyer or Martin Truex Jr., you know, could this be that Furniture Row is going to make that move to Toyota that's been rumored for so long this season?
I find that to be, and I had seen that also, and I found that to be very interesting, because I don't think there's a possibility that Martin Truex leaves Furniture Row to go be a fourth car at Ganassi,
no,
whatever they call that next year if Clint goes there. So the only possible way that Clint and Martin, in my mind, become teammates again is at Furniture Row or with some sort of merger between the two organizations, which of course throws out Bowyer and 5 Hour moving over to Ganassi. So that was a really interesting one. And I would say that the other possibility there is that Chevrolet ends up making a play to keep Furniture Row, and then you have the two of them at Furniture Row in Chevys. But it seems very likely that Furniture Row would go over to Toyota, and would seem that the assets of the 55 could end up being the second team for Furniture Row, or the 15, whatever. But that's just a really muddy mess right now, guys. That whole situation with Michael Waltrip Racing is a really muddy mess. And the sad part about that is Clint is trying his best to stay focused because he's still got a great shot at being in the chase. And I mean, there's just so much distraction and distortion going on around that whole organization that it's got to be hard for those guys to close ranks and just focus on racing from week to week at this point.
Yeah, I know. And I think he's what, maybe only 8 points outside of the chase
something
right
like
now.
That. Yeah, it,
it's really, really tight. So I know Clint wants to stay focused as everybody else over there does. They need to put a car in the chase badly. So, you know, that's a story I think we'll keep an eye on more as we get into August now and, you know, even more towards September and the start of the chase when these things start to boil out a little bit further. Tom, I know we're going to do a little bit of business here in just a second, but before we quite get there, in one word, describe the weekend at Pocono, sir.
Wow. That's hard to do in a word. I guess I would say unexpected. Because I don't think anybody expected everybody to run out of gas.
well,
I have to choose unexpected.
I was going to go more along the lines of chaos because I think that's exactly what we got in not only in the final two laps, but three green-white checkers in the truck race, the youngest super speedway winner in history in the ARCA race, everybody running out of fuel in the cup race, and I promise you, right after this, we are going to get into all of that and then some, because it's going to take about 15 minutes just to wade through everything that went on in a span of about 36 hours in the Pocono Mountains. We got more coming up on the Madness right after this. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network, the voice of motorsports.
You own a performance car and you know how to drive, but you want to learn real performance driving. Well, Bunky, get that car off the street and onto the track. Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier road racing facility, located just over an hour from D.C. in nearby Summit Point, West Virginia, is the place to go. And you'll find that Friday at the track is going to give you what you need. For less than a monthly car payment, you can attend this regularly scheduled one-day instructional event in your streetcar on one of Summit Point's three world-class road racing circuits. You'll receive classroom instruction, skid pad instruction in their cars, including front and rear skid control, and four 20-minute in-your-car instructional sessions from a professional instructor. Have fun, go fast, and really learn how to drive. Call 304-725-8444 for class schedules and details. That's 304-725-8444, Friday at the track at Summit Point Motorsports Park.
Green light. Hey, girl, school zone. I'm getting hungry. Car changing lanes. You want to meet me for pizza? Stop sign. Intersection clear. Yeah, street. Pizza sounds good. Ball in street? Girl in street!
It's hard to concentrate on two things at once, like texting and driving. Stop the text, stop the wrecks. How will you stop texting and driving? Tell us at stoptextstoprex.org. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Here's an important message from RAD and this station.
Hi, this is Bob Sheehan from Blues Traveler for RAD, Recording Artists Against Drunk Driving. I like to party just as much as the next guy, maybe even more. But the one thing I won't do after I've had a few is get in the car and drive. Don't blow it. Always choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives and so should you.
Motorsports sales professionals. Performance Motorsports is looking to build a team of experienced media sales professionals to represent our programming to the industry's top companies, magazines, and racing series. If you have motorsports sales or marketing experience, know how to work with agencies, understand social media, and are incredibly creative when it comes to working with clients and promotions, then we want to hear from you. Top performers are richly rewarded. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
Hi, this is Brandon Jones, driver of the number 33 in the Xfinity Series. Now back to Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
We're back. and we got a lot more to talk about here on Motorsports Madness. So welcome back to the Performance Motorsports Network, the voice of motorsports. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda around the Race Chaser Roundtable, and we're getting set to hash out one of the craziest weekends that I've seen in a long, long time, Tom, because it had everything. It had high drama, it had wrecks, it had overtime, we had fuel mileage, and at the end of the day, we had a winner that nobody expected. Where did Matt Kenseth come from?
Well, he got the golden horseshoe, didn't he? I mean, that was definitely a crazy finish. You know, we watched a lot of Pocono races, and I mean, I think everyone knows that there are many tracks on the circuit that I like better than Pocono in terms of action and close finishes. But you don't expect to see anything like this. It was kind of a crazy race the way it played out in the last fuel run, with everybody virtually trying to save fuel. And drivers, it was almost like a chess game of who could go the slowest while going the fastest. And what made it what made it even more dramatic was the fact that Kyle Busch, Joey Logano was leading, and Kyle Busch, even though he was trying to be conservative, was still catching him. And it got to a point where he was really closing, and then he kind of leveled off, and it was right at that point that they told him, save fuel, because Kyle Magda, it became very obvious that Kyle Busch was not going to catch Joey Logano and pass him, so his best hope to win became hoping that Joey ran out, and of course they ended up both running out. Crazy.
Guys, I couldn't tell who was good and who was not. You know, Martin Truex was in the third trying to save gas, and he didn't make it either, and that kind of surprised me a lot. And but yeah, Tom, it seemed like Kyle's car just lost the handling there toward the end of that run. And, you know, just started to save there, and it was catching him. And, you know, with this rules package, this is the same one they ran in June, so it is hard to pass, but Kyle had a really good car. And I thought Martin Truex had the best car until he slid in his pit box there on the last pit stop. But, you know, going back to that, you know, I was trying to keep up with everything. It was tough.
And, yeah, covering it, Kyle. It had to be crazy to be involved in that and be trying to think one step ahead of what was going on and what you were seeing.
Because I was surprised because I thought Joey Logano was going to be good on fuel mileage because, Jacob, the thing is that Penske's Fords have been getting good gas mileage. Brad Keselowski finished second, which I wasn't surprised with the fuel mileage. But guys, Matt Kenseth was the only Joe Gibbs Racing Toyota to make it on gas at the end. And just crazy turn of events, and I couldn't believe it. I don't think I've ever seen a Pocono race that crazy before, and I've been going there since 2002. So a lot of twists and turns in that race, Jacob. And, I mean, it was just crazy from my viewpoint.
Kyle Busch was within a mile and a quarter of winning four straight races. He probably should have, but of course, you know, then the whole fuel thing happened. His teammate gives JGR four straight wins, and Matt Kenseth cements his place in the chase. Kyle was in the top 30. When he ran out of fuel, he was outside the top 30, but he still makes up ground on 30th, so he's still got five more races to make it happen. This week at Watkins Glen, going to be arguably one of his best shots to go to victory lane again. But more importantly, Tom, the chaos of this fuel mileage run at the end, you hit the nail on the head. It was a tale of two halves. Seven cautions in the first 80 laps, only one in the last 80 laps. And the thing that killed me was the fact that one of those guys that brought out one of the first seven cautions is one of the guys that I have a feeling probably would have been a great saver of gas towards the end of this race. The closer, Kevin Harvick, blew up on lap 20.
Yeah, you don't very often see that team have a motor problem, and that was unfortunate because I do think you're right. I think Kevin would have been right in it at the end. He certainly had a car to contend with. And of course, Matt Kenseth winning, Matt's one of the worst at saving gas by his own admission. He never has any luck in those gas saving fuel mileage type outcomes, but he certainly did this time. Like I said, it was almost like he inherited the golden horseshoe. He was just the one sitting in the right spot when everybody else in front of him ran dry. Jacob, it was crazy, but it was fun. As it was fun to watch. And I still think what we take out of this before we move on to Trucks and ARCA, guys, I still think the takeaway from this is that even though Kyle Busch lost the race and he isn't in the top 30, he gained on the top 30. And he's still, to me right now, that's still the team to beat as we go into Watkins Glen. I look at two cars, him and the 47 of A.J. Allmendinger, as being those two guys are who you got to go through.
Of course he's the team to beat, and he's a former winner at Watkins Glen, too. So now we backtrack a day to Saturday, and we started Saturday with a truck race, coincidentally talking about Kyle Busch again, because he made his first truck start since, oh, I don't know, last year. And let's see, what did he do in his first Xfinity start back?
He won.
What did he do, Kyle Magda, in his first truck start back? In spite of three green-white checkers, and I picked him to do it, he won!
Oh, and by the way, Mr. Two-Inch Limb, Kevin Harvick blew up, so just saying. But no, I mean, yeah, he goes and wins. And you know, just crazy race. You know, I think what really caught my attention, Jacob, was the battle between him and Eric Jones in the end. You know, Eric was trying to run him down there. 8 laps to go and the caution comes out when a piece of debris comes off of Matt Crafton's truck. I mean, that was setting up to be a great finish, and it still was. But, you know, Eric Jones, you know, didn't get – the cards didn't go his way there in the end. You know, then he had to fly to Iowa. So, but for Kyle, I mean, Jacob, Dollar General sweeps the weekend. Kyle wins the truck race Saturday. Matt Kenseth wins Sunday. So it was a good weekend for them. But, yeah, I mean, Kyle Busch, I had a fast truck in practice, qualified second for the race, grabbed the lead there from Eric Jones early on. And, you know, it was just – there were so many things that happened during that race. It was crazy, especially that four-wide battle for the lead toward the end. But, yeah, I mean, Kyle just drove away there. I mean, Kevin Harvick really didn't have anything for him. I know Kevin took four there late in the race, but just he was struggling all weekend long. And for that team to do what they did – and same thing with Tyler Reddick, you know, was third. So, you know, it was just a busy, busy weekend there. And with the truck race, there were so many stories coming out of that race. You know, even with Matt Crafton and Brad Keselowski. Matt Crafton, I think, blaming Brad Keselowski that he wrecked him because he wants Tyler Reddick to win the championship. So I don't believe anything.
Let's go into that pot for a minute, because Tom, there's two Christmas cards that I don't think are going to be handed out at the end of this year. Eric Jones is definitely not going to give Austin Dillon a Christmas card, and Matt Crafton surely as heck is not going to give Brad Keselowski a Christmas card. Heck, he blamed him and said that Keselowski took him out intentionally. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, Matt needs to put the tin hat away and just concentrate on running his truck and actually turning when he gets into a corner. It was obvious that Matt just went straight going into the turn and came up into and across the nose of Keselowski. Brad had nothing whatsoever to do with that wreck and has no reason to jump in the truck and go try and crash Matt Crafton just so Tyler Reddick can be helped in the points. In the end, Matt Crafton, every year, if you look at this, there's at least one race where Matt Crafton self-destructs. That was it. And this is why Matt doesn't win more championships in the trucks as a driver. It's because he just simply forgets what he's doing sometimes. And nothing's ever his fault. Matt needs to get a grip. That was just silly. As for the Dillon Jones thing is sort of a mystery to me, because, you know, they're kind of like magnets. They seem to find each other on the track often, Jake, but I really don't understand exactly what the whole feud is about, other than they just end up in the same spot at the same time. I don't know that I can think of a catalyst for why that situation has deteriorated, but it's kind of been interesting to watch. But I don't know. The whole Crafton thing was just unbelievable to me, for him to think that Brad had anything to do with that when it was clear that Brad was just driving around the corner up in the top groove and Matt invaded his space. You know, it was like, come on.
I'll take Bizarre Afternoon for $1,000,
yes.
Alex.
Yes.
All right,
like
Kyle Magda.
Bizarre Weekend.
Yeah, Bizarre Weekend, which in the middle of all this was an ARCA race that had a bizarre incident on lap one, Kyle, that took out half the field. And at the end of it, hey, we had another first-time winner. 9 of the last 10 ARCA winners have been first-timers, and Junior Motorsports finally has a bright spot that's not a Cup driver. How about Cole Custer?
How about Wayne Peterson?
Well, that I know officially it's a Wayne Peterson win, but yeah, we all know that that's all Junior Motorsports stuff, crew car, everything.
You know what? I wrote about this in my column today on Race Chaser, and the irony I find out of all of this is that's an old Chase Elliott car, and Jacob, who did he beat to be the youngest super speedway winner ever in ARCA?
Chase Elliott.
Exactly. So that's just kind of a little irony by 2 days, by the way. But, yeah, I mean, it was a crazy race, you know. First, I got to give a shout-out to Matt Kurzyeski for that race. Led 28 laps there. And the two tires did just not work on his car. And he said even in the post-race he wanted to take 4. But Custer took 2 as well. I think it was kind of a domino effect there. But, you know, it was a good race. You know, Cole Custer worked that last restart to perfection and just drove away from everybody. You know, by the time Grandfinger got by Kurzyeski, he was already 5 seconds ahead. So, you know, it was good for Cole, being on there, Jacob. There's so many stories out of that race for Kyle Weatherman losing it on the first lap and causing the chaos that there was. There's so much to discuss, and we'll probably go more into it on Thursday night show.
Yeah, we will. It was a lot of fun, and it was fun watching Cole and Matt battle. They put on a great fight at the front of the field for a long time, and, you know, my heart really broke for Kurzyeski because I know he and that whole Brian Keselowski team want to win so badly, and it's coming for them, I feel like. That 54 team's going to be one to contend with later in this season, and, again, we'll talk more about that later in the week. Right now, we're going to do some business, come back, and move to the open wheel side of life, talk with Joel Sebastianelli, because the madness was not limited to Pocono. We had craziness in Mid-Ohio, and this IndyCar championship fight is going to be one for the ages, I have a feeling. We'll talk about that after this. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
Do you love the sound of high revving motors and the smell of burning rubber? Do you want to get your car sideways right at the ragged edge of control? If you've always wanted to try drifting or learn to improve your drifting skills, Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier motorsports facility, has the expert instructors and the specialized track to teach you how to drift and the skills necessary to drift competitively. From skid pad to open sessions, Summit Point Motorsports Park has the safe and open environment that allows drifters of all skill levels, new to intermediate, to get sideways and smoking. With a focus on safety and the skill set necessary to drift competitively, Summit Point Motorsports Park's Drift Nirvana is just the thing for you. Call for your reservation today, 304-725-8444. Or for more information, go online, summitpoint-raceway.com, or you can email them at office@bsrinc.com. Drift Nirvana, getting you sideways the right way.
A boy born in Joplin, Missouri was fascinated by anything with wheels and a motor. The odds of him going on to fascinate millions with his talent? 1 in 260,000. The odds of this born racer having 157 career top 10 finishes in NASCAR? 1 in 125 billion. But every driver seeks the pinnacle of their achievements. The odds of him winning both the Daytona 500 and the Brickyard 400 in the same year? 1 in 195 million. The odds of a child being diagnosed with autism? 1 in 68. I'm NASCAR driver Jamie McMurray, and my niece has autism. Learn more at autismspeaks.org/signs. Early diagnosis can make a lifetime of difference. Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
You're listening to the Performance Motorsports Network, your authority on motorsports of all types. Be listening for the most accurate and up-to-the-minute coverage of every motorsports activity that you enjoy on a daily basis. Be it NASCAR, be it IRL, be it Formula One, be it drag racing, be it dirt track, off-road, props, hulls, whatever. We are your source for motorsports. Performance Motorsports Network. Time now for Open Wheel Central with our resident wine and cheeser, Joe Sebastianelli. Here to pop the cork is Race Chaser Online's managing editor, Jacob Seelman.
Welcome back to Motorsports Madness, and if you thought the first half hour was fun, sit back, relax, and get ready for even more of it, because there's still a lot to hash out. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda, Joel Sebastianelli now joins us. We've grabbed the cheese and crackers, and you know, for because he's of age, the you know, the wine and other unsundry assortment.
They complement each other nicely.
Yeah, they well, yeah, you would know this because you're a Formula One fan, but that's not what we're going to talk about first. Joel, what a 5 weeks it's been for the United States of America. Four wins in the last five races, capped off with one of the most incredible Honda Indy 200s at Mid-Ohio that I have ever seen. Cautions falling exactly when certain people needed them. Cautions for other people not falling when they needed them to. And at the end of it all, 30 years to the weekend, for all intents and purposes, of his father's first win at his hometown track, the hometown hero Graham Rahal wins his second race of the season. And you couldn't even believe it when I told you that there's 9 points between Juan Montoya and Graham Rahal headed to Pocono in 3 weeks.
I know. When we were already on our way back, so we were in the airport watching this race, JP Manarola and I, the other host of Road to Indy TV, and we were watching this, and I could have sworn it said 10 points up on the board, which was still crazy to me. You know, I texted you, 10 points? Really? And turns out it's even lower than that. I still can't believe that it's happened like this. Two rough weekends for Juan Pablo Montoya in a row. Graham Rahal with four straight races inside the top five. Two of those victories, three of them podiums. The other was a fourth at Iowa. Rahal is on a roll. And we went from having this being Juan Pablo Montoya's to lose. As I've said multiple times, I thought he, for the most part, had this wrapped up, barring something crazy at Sonoma. We don't have to wait until Sonoma. Something crazy is happening right now with just two races to go. How cool is it to see Graham Rahal? You have the connection with the father. You have the connection with the state of Ohio. He actually it was one of the coolest things I've ever seen. It was an Ohio State Buckeyes football helmet painted onto his racing helmet with the Buckeye Leaf helmet stickers and all, one for each podium. It was just so cool. We have ourselves a show, don't we?
We do, Joel. And I would contend that now, instead of this being Juan Pablo Montoya's championship to lose, I am of the persuasion that this has become Graham Rahal's championship to win, because we've seen over the last three or four races, he's got the hottest hand in the entire series and everything is going his way. So my belief here is that now he's got the momentum on his side. He's got luck on his side. My belief is that if Graham Rahal just keeps his head about him and avoids the big mistake, and the team avoids the big mistake on a pit stop or whatever, and can just keep him competitive the way he is now, I believe this has become his championship to win. And Joel, if we just assume for a moment that I'm right and we assume that he wins the title, what does this do for IndyCar in terms of the future? Because this is a one-car team that wasn't even on the map when this season started as a championship contender. Steak and Shake comes on board. Graham gets hot, goes out, starts winning, starts running up front, and all of a sudden, this looks for all the world, Joel, like magic. It may be about to happen, and David slewing Goliath. And what would that do for IndyCars, Joel, if Graham wins this title?
Hang on. I just want to add, by the way, best marketing stunt that I've seen of the entire weekend for Graham to have a Steak and Shake milkshake in Victory Lane.
Yes.
Oh, I mean, Steak and Shake is killing it in the marketing game. They really are.
Agreed.
They're so great at it. You know, for Rahal winning, to be honest, I don't know how much it really does to IndyCar, because it's a lot about promotion. I mean, Graham Rahal winning doesn't just excite the United States of America. You know, it's sort of the same argument. If a tree falls in the forest and no one's around to hear it, did it really happen? I think it has the potential to do a ton. But people are just assuming it's going to do everything on its own. I think it's going to take great marketing, continued by companies like Steak and Shake getting on board behind Graham and other drivers. It's going to take the series to market this guy, for Graham to help get himself out there. I think to racing fans, maybe this turns more of them on. Maybe some people who haven't watched since the split, but hearing the Ray Hall name on top of Indy again will get them to watch. I think it certainly is to the benefit, and it's a really, really exciting time for the series, but everyone's going to have to pitch in and do their part to make sure that this big thing fulfills its huge potential.
Well, I think I was more referring to not so much what it would do for the relationship to the fans, although that was a great point that you made. That's all about marketing promotion. I think I was talking more about within the sport, you know, you have all these drivers. Simon Pagenaud left the team to go to Penske. You know, you have all these drivers that they all look at Ganassi. They all look at Penske. It's all about the super teams. It's all about the big teams. Well, here's a one-car team coming out of nowhere and not just getting a lucky start to the season and hanging on, but literally chasing down Juan Pablo Montoya. And so, Joel, that's really where I was going with this. What does this do to the perception and the balance of competition in IndyCar? And suddenly some of these drivers now looking at saying, well, maybe I don't need to be with a Penske or a Ganassi. Maybe I just need to be with the right people. And any of these, you know, top five, six teams can actually win and win regularly.
I mean, you make a really great point there, too, the point that you were actually trying to make before I misinterpreted it. It's very relevant right now, too, because the hot rumor out of the weekend is that Joseph Newgarden is favored to take a seat at Ganassi next year. Chip really wants Joseph Newgarden, and so you wonder. I mean, Joseph Newgarden's having the best season of his career right now with Carpenter Fisher Hartman. He has his first two career victories. He's eighth in the championship right now. How many Ganassi drivers is Joseph Newgarden beating? Well, he's beating Charlie Kimball. He's actually ahead of Tony Kanaan by 16 points. And Tony's one of the top two drivers on that team, obviously. And, you know, Sage Karam obviously hasn't run the full year, but you know, Sage has only had two top five finishes, too. And a Sebastian Saavedra never had a top five finish, just a top 10 at Long Beach. So I think that there is something to be said for the fact that now, especially with parity how it is, I think sometimes those big teams, either the focus can't just stay on one driver, so it evens it out a little bit. You know, maybe instead of having one super strong team, you have a really, really good team, but guys take wins and finishes away from each other, if that makes sense. When you're the one-car team for Graham Rahal right now, it's not just a one-car team, but he's the only Honda inside the top six. So he has the manufacturer throwing weight behind him. There is definitely a solid argument to be made right now because of Graham Rahal and because of Joseph Newgarden that a one-car team, maybe a two-car team, that's the way to go, because Penske and Ganassi are strong. They're always going to be. But we'll see if Joseph actually heeds this advice that he's helping to teach right now.
I'm a firm believer in chemistry, and I don't think Simon Pagenaud has any better chemistry where he is right now with Penske than what he had last year. And I think sometimes it can be dangerous to just always assume that I have to be with Team A or Team B. All we got to do is look at NASCAR now, and the balance of power has shifted completely right now away from Hendrick Motorsports. We're hardly even talking about them from race to race. It's all about Joe Gibbs and Stuart Haas Racing. IndyCar has become such a parity-driven situation right now. If I'm Joseph Newgarden, I'm staying right where I am and continuing to be the top dog in that program instead of just one of the dogs at Chip Ganassi. That's just my two cents, but I'm telling you, I like the way some of these teams are structured, and some of these drivers need to look very carefully at what they're going to gain by going across. The grass is not always greener, Joel, on the other side, as we've discovered.
No, it's not always greener. And again, you actually make a really good point about that chemistry. And Schmidt-Peterson Motorsports is another one. I mean, look at Sebastian Bourdais running sixth right now. He has two victories this season. Bourdais hasn't had a multi-win season in a few years since this year. So, I mean, his performance has really picked up alongside Stefano Coletti, who has one top 10 finish at Indianapolis on the road course, and everything else has just been a mess at the back of the field. It's a two-car team, but the focus is clearly on Bourdais. That's the number one car, not as spread out. So I think that there is something to be said about the nature of IndyCar now, where you got to have the budget, of course. But if you've got the budget, a one- or two-car team can absolutely take it to Ganassi and Penske, not just race by race, but over the course of an entire season.
And see, the whole entire season thing is what we've been, you know, what we've been looking at, watching. It's been, I don't know, Joel, this feels like it's been kind of a wild season from start to finish. A lot of things that we haven't expected, a few things that we have. And the one thing that I'm looking at here is Scott Dixon got a big break with the caution at the tail end of the race. And, you know, we'll talk more about the conundrum behind what happened in the final 10 laps on the other side of the break. But he's 34 points off the championship lead. He made a decent move, but needed a little bit more. Is Scott still in contention with this, with just two races to go?
Well, I was thinking it was win or bust for Mr. Mid-Ohio. Put the car on the pole again, a phenomenal performance. And because of that incident involving his teammate Sage Karam, he did salvage a top five finish. He went from being outside the top 10 all the way up to fourth. So, yes, he lost some points to Graham Rahal, but he chipped into the margin Juan Pablo Montoya had, finished higher than Castro Neves in power. I think that Scott Dixon is definitely still in this race. He's only 24 points back.
And that's going to be the key that
we're
going to...
I can't count. I told you that on Sunday. You realized. I can't even count Graham Rahal's point margin.
Well, you can only count to 33 to begin with, so there is that.
Yeah, 34. It's outside the range.
We're going to do this business, teach Joel how to do math, and come back with more after this. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network, the voice of motorsports.
Okay, so Sarah, I'm dropping you off at Emily's?
Yep.
And Josh, you're going to?
Soccer, Dad. Soccer practice.
Right. Oh, by the way, I just wanted to let you know when I pick you both up, I'll be wearing my short shorts.
What?
No!
Yep. And my dorky dad hat, and I'm gonna do my dad dance for all your friends. They'll love it!
Seriously? Why?
Because I like my short shorts. Of course, I could be talked out of it if you guys would just buckle up your seatbelts without giving me a hard time.
It's important to get your kids to buckle up for safety, no matter what it takes. And sometimes, all it takes is your parental powers of persuasion.
Okay, okay, we're buckling up.
See, all buckled.
Good choice. I'll just have to do my dad dance at dinner time. What?
No!
Do what you have to make sure your kids are wearing their seatbelts, even on short drives. Never give up until they buckle up. A message from the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council. Visit safercar.gov/kidsbuckleup for more information.
Parents, your son or daughter has had their license for a while now, but you want to make sure they're prepared for any situation they may face on the road. High school driver's ed doesn't teach them to drive defensively. They need to be prepared for any highway emergency. For less than a month's insurance, and a whole lot less, BSR instructors at Summit Point Motorsports Park in nearby Summit Point, West Virginia, will teach your son or daughter how to respond instantly and positively to unexpected situations on the road. BSR's specialized accident avoidance training teaches swerve to avoid maneuvers at highway speeds, ocular driving, which focuses driving attention on ways to avoid accidents, vehicle dynamics and feedback, skid control and skid recovery, threshold braking on straights and progressive braking on curves, and off-road recovery techniques. This is stuff driver's ed simply doesn't teach. So call BSR today, 304-725-8444. Give your kid the skill set needed to drive safely and responsibly on the highway. That's 304-725-8444.
This is a test to find out if you know it all when it comes to children. Name one of the leading killers of U.S. children age 1 to 13. What's the best way to protect children in a car crash? At what age and size should a child start using a booster seat?
Don't assume you know it all when it comes to car seats for your child. Go to safercar.gov/the right seat and know for sure. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Let's throw the green for Open Wheel Central on Motorsports Madness. Back to Jacob, the crew, and the only racing insider to ever use Snuggies for Dogs in a conversation about IndyCar, Joel Sebastianelli.
Yeah, I have a feeling before the end of this season, there may be a few more snuggies for dogs, and none of them are going to be for the reasons that we thought going into the year. But in any case, welcome back to Motorsports Madness. Jacob Seelman, Joel, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda, all around the round table. And I hate using the word gate in anything, but since Robin Miller and Marshall Pruitt brought it up earlier today, I'm going to use it. Joel. Before the break, I mentioned that Scott Dixon caught a break by the late race caution that flew. They're calling it Sage Gate because there's a lot of rumors that young Mr. Karam may have spun on purpose to try and help his teammate. Do you buy it? Do you sell it? Robin Miller seems to think IndyCar's taking a good long look at this one, and I've watched it back three or four times. I don't know.
Yeah, I grew up about 25 minutes outside Gillette Stadium. I'm pretty tired of hearing the word attached to everything, too. Well, you know, IndyCar has to take a look at it, and with good reason. The caution, when it came out, it's not just about the fact that Sage Karam looked a little offline and that it was a strange corner, but when you consider all the circumstances, what's been rumored and what we know. What we know is that lap 66, Scott Dixon was in trouble. He led the first 22 laps of the race, but got shuffled mid-pack, was outside the top 10 for a little while, and rejoined after a pit stop in 12th. Just a couple laps later, Karam goes around, and what apparently one of the crew guys down below from a team not identified told Robin Miller is that Julian, who I guess Julian Robertson from Dixon's team, came running down to Sage's pit and told his guys to tell Karam the gearbox pressure is rising or the gearbox is getting hot. Is that actually a legitimate thing? I don't know why that information would go from team to team, but who knows? I mean, it totally could be. But you also take it out of context, or perhaps what may be in context, and it looks suspicious. Obviously, people who that incident affected. So the Penske's, of course, Graham Rahal is not going to complain about it at all. But the people who were affected by that caution in the championship hunt, obviously, everyone's going to want to take a hard look at that and say, oh, well, you know, clearly Karam did it. The truth is, I just don't know. I've looked at it a bunch of times, and at the risk of undermining any opinion I've ever had on this show, the fact of the matter is I'm just not a driver. I don't have enough experience behind the wheel to listen to the onboard, to see what he did, and dispute his claim that he was just adjusting the brake bias and got caught out and made a terrible corner. I can't just dispute that from what I've seen. I have to err on the side of wait and see. IndyCar is definitely going to look into this. And whatever they decide on Wednesday, or if that comes a little bit later, I think we'll know a lot more. It's really hard to get away with stuff like this. So if they did it, I'm confident that IndyCar will get the truth out. And if there wasn't any foul play, if it was legitimate, then you know what? I'm totally going to believe that if that's what the ensuing investigation shows.
Well, they need to check Sage's phone, because we need to find out if perhaps Michael Waltrip sent a text just before.
Ouch. Yes.
That says, hey, man, I got an idea.
But Tom, if they get Michael Waltrip's phone, then they can see the text messages from there. Sage doesn't have to turn it in.
That's right.
I wouldn't if I was him.
Look, it's this was a crazy situation. When I watched it, it didn't seem like it was anything abnormal. I mean, Sage is a rookie. We all know that he likes the gas foot, and you know, for the most part, that's, you know, not been a bad thing, but every once in a while he makes somebody kind of mad. I mean, if that's what happened, and if that's what we find out happened, then I think IndyCar is going to probably deal with this in a little less dramatic a way than NASCAR did, at least I would hope. But certainly there should be severe penalties for this kind of stuff. You just can't have that crap. It undermines the integrity of everything that goes on in a race and with a series. And, you know, I'm very leery of this until I see reason to be. There's never been an issue with Ganassi or with Sage or with anything like this. It isn't as though there's been past precedent. You got to kind of, I mean, it's no different than what we were talking about earlier with, you know, Matt Crafton blaming Brad Keselowski for, you know, crashing him on purpose so his teammate could take the points lead or whatever. You know, a lot of stuff gets said in the heat of the moment. This is just a little bit too odd for me, Joel. I understand the timing, but it's interesting. We'll see where it goes.
Yeah, we will. I think that, is, you know, looking back, there is some, I don't know if you want to call it precedent, but there's past history. The one that comes to mind, speaking of Gates, is Crashgate, the Renault Formula One controversy when Nelson Piquet Jr. intentionally wrecked in order to gain an advantage for Fernando Alonso. That conspiracy knocked Flavio Briatore out of the sport. It had such an overreaching effect on the entire team, on the sport as a whole. Yep. I just can't imagine that with a double points race at Sonoma, with another race still to go, and the fact that this wasn't ever going to give a victory to Scott Dixon or really catch out any of the other drivers. Yep. It was just to help Scott Dixon pick up, what, 6 or 7 spots? I can't imagine that in his entire time around IndyCar that Chip Ganassi would dream this up as a master plan and go ahead to do it. And it just doesn't make sense to me, but it doesn't mean it's not possible.
Well, that was my point, though, is, I mean, you know, F1 is F1. Everybody knows and accepts that F1 manipulates outcomes on a regular basis amongst their teams telling guys to move over so somebody else can go by or whatever. That F1 is a whole different type of situation. There's been nothing that I know of that's ever occurred with anything Chip Ganassi's ever done that would suggest to me that they would do this. And as you said, it really wasn't going to help Dixon win. I mean, you know, this to me just seems like a really odd coincidence. But again, if they find out there's something to it, then it needs to be dealt with appropriately. That's my opinion anyway.
Ouch. Well, all right. That's going to make Wednesday, I think, very interesting, Joel. So with that said, we have a little bit of a weird conundrum on our hands, my friend. There's no open wheel racing this weekend. What?
I don't really know what I'm supposed to do with myself. What do you normally do when there's no racing? Although you travel everywhere and cover just about everything. Have you even had one of those?
I actually had one over the weekend, and it's the first time in I don't know how long that I sat at home and just didn't do a whole lot.
That doesn't really sound that intriguing to me.
I know. I know.
I think what you need to do, Joel, is spend your entire weekend eating popcorn and watching old YouTube Indy 500 broadcasts.
And hey, at some point, I may break at least one or two of those out. I'll be back home in Rhode Island, so I'll whip out the HDMI cord on the big TV. It's something to do until we get F1 and IndyCar back, but at least we have stuff to talk about, right?
Exactly. Yeah. We do have stuff to talk about because we go to we look ahead to Formula One for a couple weeks, and hey, we're going to Spa. Coming up, I think it's the same weekend that IndyCar's in Pocono, actually. So, you know, and I like the Belgian Grand Prix. I don't know what everybody else's opinion is on it, Joel. And I'm with you, though. This is one of my favorite circuits of the year, even if it doesn't always put on the best show, because it's just so darn pretty up there.
Yes.
It usually does put on a great show, though. Spa is,
yes,
without a doubt, one of the top 5 racetracks in the world. I think that's almost a unanimous selection among anybody who loves racing on an international level. Eau Rouge is such an amazing corner. The G-force going up at uphill, then into the Kemmel Strait where they're hitting above 200 miles per hour. It's such a great track. There's always the weather issue. If it's not raining at Spa, wait a little while and it will. There's unpredictability, everything that we love about Formula One and racing in general, Spa can bring to the table. Michael Schumacher and other legends of the sport have won there, but you've also had some surprises there too over the years. It's a beautiful racetrack. It's a fun racetrack, most importantly. And at a time where some of the legendary tracks in F1 have some sort of a questionable future, although I did see that Monza is supposedly confirmed for next year. Sounds like they've worked that out, which is nice. You know, Yves Spa actually had a pretty... I wouldn't say that they were close to losing it, but there was still a rumor about possibly alternating that race with France, with Paul Ricard. I'm glad it didn't. This is one of those tracks that just needs to stay because it's something that makes me love Formula One. The stuff like this, it just brings a smile to my face waking up in the morning and being there. And for most of the drivers, they'll all tell you they love Spa, and they'll tell you the exact same thing. It just has this special appeal that draws everybody in, and I can't think of a better place to go after the summer break than to get our racing fix in Belgium again.
Oh, I know. And what's going to be different is Mercedes is going to be trying to do something that they haven't done since 1955 and win the Belgian Grand Prix. I never thought there was going to be a time when I would say that. They've not won it in 60 years.
Well, it certainly seems like it would be possible, you know, with the season Mercedes has had, especially considering that Lewis Hamilton has won here before. He won with McLaren in 2010. Right now, Hamilton is at the top of his form. 9 of the 10 pole positions this season have gone to Lewis. Nico snuck in there with one at Catalunya. So they've swept the poles. They've won most of the races aside from 2 that Sebastian Vettel managed to sneak in there. I think that on a track where there's a lot of flat-out portions, it's a fast track, it's a long track, equipment's crucial here, I think that that's going to line things up for a Mercedes victory. But especially if it rains, who knows what's going to happen? We thought Mercedes would dominate last year, and the two guys, for all intents and purposes, knocked each other out of victory and sent us down a road to the end of the 2014 season that'll be talked about for years. Spa's always fun. I'm excited for it. Not excited for this weekend. I don't know what I'm going to do.
Well, we'll dream up something for you, Joel. Maybe we'll have to ship you some more wine and cheese.
More wine and cheese, yes.
That's Joel Sebastianelli. We wrap up this edition of Open Wheel Central, and we'll have to invent something for him to come on and talk about next week. But until we get that far, we're going to do this business and come back and stay on the open wheel side, but go to the dirt, because Honda USAC National Midget star Tanner Thorson is going to be our featured live guest at the top of the hour, and that's right after this. You're listening to Motorsports Madness here on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
You own a performance car, and you know how to drive, but you want to learn real performance driving. Well, Bunky, get that car off the street and onto the track. Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier road racing facility, located just over an hour from D.C. in nearby Summit Point, West Virginia, is the place to go, and you'll find that Friday at the track is going to give you what you need. For less than a monthly car payment, you can attend this regularly scheduled one-day instructional event in your streetcar on one of Summit Point's 3 world-class road racing circuits. You'll receive classroom instruction, skid pad instruction in their cars, including front and rear skid control, and 4 20-minute in-your-car instructional sessions from a professional instructor. Have fun, go fast, and really learn how to drive. Call 304-725-8444 for class schedules and details. That's 304-725-8444. Friday at the track at Summit Point Motorsports Park.
Every 30 minutes, another innocent person is killed due to a drunk driver.
My best friend.
My brother.
My poor grandchild.
My sister.
My father.
My husband.
My mom. My mommy.
Stop these tragedies before they happen. Don't drink and drive.
The Performance Motorsports Network is a compilation of shows about motorsports. From technical to controversial to just fun, everything you like about racing and gearhead stuff is right here on one internet channel. The Performance Motorsports Network. Tell your friends about it.
Hi, I'm Reed Sorensen. Racing has been a part of me and my family for as long as I can remember. I had to make tough choices early on to get to the top. It took hard work and dedication, but it's those tough choices that helped me prepare for challenges I would face as a Cup driver. Make the right choices today and be ready for the challenges tomorrow.
You're listening to Speed 77 Radio on the Performance Motorsports Network. Now back to Jacob, Tom, and Kyle on Motorsports Madness.
Welcome back to the Performance Motorsports Network, the voice of motorsports, and we have got another hour of conversation here on Motorsports Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda at the round table, and to kick off our second hour, Tom, this is going to be fun because it's been a while since we've been able to go to the USAC side of life on this show, but we get to do so right now with a young gun who, in my opinion, is one of those that, like a Christopher Bell, like a Rico Abreu, like a Kyle Larson, he's on his way up in the sport, and that's always a good sign. Tanner Thorson is one of those that is the next gen that I'm keeping my eye on.
Well, yeah, that's really what we specialize in our shows here. We always like to keep our audience informed of who are the next gen guys, and I think you hit the nail right on the head. I think Tanner Thorson is basically going to be that next Christopher Bell, that next Kyle Larson, or that next Rico Abreu, at least from a talent standpoint and in terms of the people he's surrounded by and the company he keeps. I think he's right in position to be the next in line to potentially maybe make that move, and I think we ought to ask him about it.
I do think we got to ask him about it, and with that, we'll pull him out of the pits and let him go full throttle with us. Tanner Thorson, first off, welcome to Motorsports Madness, and I say that with you coming off a pretty interesting drive, I think, in your mind over the weekend at the Belleville Midget Nationals. The whole team was right up there in the mix, and it just seemed like none of you guys could quite get to the front to challenge Brian Clawson for the win.
Yeah, thanks for having me. It was one heck of a weekend, I tell you what. Belleville Nationals is a great show to go to every year. It's such a prestigious race. And, it was a good night. Thursday night, we came off third place, started fourth, I want to say. And then Saturday night, it was kind of a less likely track to run. It rubbered down like 10 laps into the race, and it allowed everybody else to save the tires that were up front a little bit more because they knew there was rubber there, and it just let Brian Clawson drive away from us.
All right. You know, let's back up a minute because I'm sure a lot of our audience has not heard your name, or if they have heard it, they're probably just starting to hear it over the last year or two. Talk a little bit about how you got started. I mean, you started in the Mini Outlaw carts, and you've moved up into the USAC midgets. You've run open wheel competition across the country. I mean, hash out a little bit of that for our audience because it's been a pretty fun road for you since you got started about 8 years ago. Now,
yeah, I started racing outlaw carts when I was 4 years old up in Northern Nevada and Northern California. I'm from Northern Nevada, but we were always racing in California. Raced up the ranks, you box stock 250, open intermediate, open. And as soon as I got up into the 250 class, Rico Avery's dad, David Avery, got a hold of me and asked me if I'd be interested in driving their cars for them. It raced for them in the 250 class for 2 years, then got into the open intermediate, won a championship in that, and then the year after that I ran open intermediate and open and got a rookie of the year in the open class and also winning that championship. And it after that David's like, all right, well, I guess we're moving up the next step, and brought me into the stable with Keith Coons and Rico and Christopher Bell and Kyle Larson. So that was pretty cool. And been racing the Keith Coons midgets for like 3 years now. And I got an opportunity to run a wing sprint car out in Northern California, and we were really successful there. Didn't work out too well there towards the end, but we were really successful. We ran second with the Outlaws, only my fourth show out in a wing car. And then we also got our first win right after that, the weekend after that.
Okay, so let's back up just for a second because I want to talk about the Mini Outlaw division a little bit. this is a division that, for those in our audience who are not real familiar with it, this is a division that has been big out west for a little while now in the western part of the U.S., not so much on the East Coast until just the last couple of years when it's really kind of started to explode. And Tanner, I'm curious what your perspective is when you look at the Mini Outlaws in general. And they call them carts, but I really think that's I think that's bad. I wish they'd just call them Mini Outlaw cars, because even though I know they're kind of structurally in a way like a go-kart, the horsepower to weight ratio, especially the open class of these things, is very much the same as a 410 sprint car, like a World of Outlaws sprint car. This is a serious class of car and one that's a great driver training tool. I'm curious what your perspective is on the growth of this division and obviously the benefit that it's had for you just getting involved with the Abreus and the people that you're with now.
Yeah, it is one heck of a class. They there's nothing like them, that's for sure. They're super fast. They handle great. They're a little bit of a rigid ride because there's no suspension. But
right.
Yeah, I agree with you on that whole not calling it a cart thing, because there's nothing else like it. They're pretty awesome. I think the best thing that happened to them was when Jimmy Elledge took over QRC, because Jimmy Elledge is out there in the NASCAR country out there in North Carolina, and it allowed him to bring his business out there, and then they got that track out in Millbridge, North Carolina, and it's definitely growing pretty big, and it's actually getting bigger in Illinois as well too. So pretty soon, heck, everybody's going to have them, and I know a bunch of people in Illinois that I race midgets with are starting to get them, and they love them. They're fun to drive. They're not the easiest things to drive, which I think makes them a little bit more fun, because you got more of a you got another learning curve. You know, these guys that race the midgets see where I came from and how I got to the level I'm at, and it's pretty cool to see that.
Yeah, it is neat, and you've got, like you said, you've got QRC with Jimmy Elledge, you've got SKE Karts with Kyle Beatty, you've got Ryan Foster Racing, you got several guys that are building them and dealing them and all of that, and it's just, it's neat to see how it's kind of come east, and now the Midwest, as you say, Illinois, and some of those places out there are starting to notice them and pick them up. And I think this is, I think it's a very fast growing class. And I just have always thought that calling them a cart almost is, it doesn't do them justice. And it almost subtracts volatility, which these things certainly can get upside down just like a sprint car. But the fact that they have so many different divisions, you know, makes it easy for someone to get started at a young age without all the horsepower and then just keep graduating up. The follow-up question I had to that, though, Tanner, was you've gotten up, as you say, into the midgets, and you've dabbled quite successfully in the World of Outlaws. I mean, you know, we've seen the migration of Rico Abreu over to asphalt and to the stock cars. We've seen the migration of Christopher Bell over to the asphalt, to the late models, to the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series. Is this in the future for you?
Definitely. That's the biggest goal. One of the biggest goals I've had ever since I started racing, ever since I knew racing, was to make it to NASCAR. My favorite driver was Dale Jarrett, and now obviously as junior, I grew up with the number 88. So that's obviously one of the biggest goals for me. I mean, I would love to stick around and run dirt stuff, but as soon as I can get into asphalt, I'm definitely going to get up into there. Like Kyle Larson said in one of his interviews, that's what pays the bills. So it's definitely a big goal for me, and I'm definitely looking forward to it.
All right, Tanner, you know, you speak of the dirt, though, because it's what's got you started really quickly. You made a big milestone about 2 months ago now. You actually picked up your first USAC National Midget win during the opening night of Indiana Midget Week at Gas City. Now, how big was that for you, for your confidence, for that team after working so hard for 2 years with Keith Koons to finally see it pay off?
Yeah, it was pretty emotional. I don't really show my emotions too much out in public, but deep down inside, it was definitely one of the greatest feelings I could ever have so far in my racing career. To know that USAC has been around for so long, and it definitely was awesome. It was a good confidence builder too, because I mean, I've been really close these last 3 years that I've raced for them, and to finally pick it up, I picked a couple power ride wins up, and finally pick up this USAC win was incredible. The confidence that it builds and it competition, you know, that comes with the USAC is pretty crazy too. It's so great to be able to run up front with all the major competition that's out there.
As one of the young guys in the sport, you know, are you happy with where things are at right now? Are you happy with the progression that you've made over the past couple of years? Or are you looking, you know, trying to push it even harder, you know, not being satisfied with where you're at this stage? I mean, I know you see Kyle, Rico, Chris, even, you know, already making that transition to pavement. Are you a little frustrated maybe not quite having made that jump just yet?
I wouldn't use frustrated. It's more of I don't know. It's not frustrated. I'm satisfied with where I'm at, obviously, but I definitely am trying to push harder to get to those positions. It does make me want to push even harder, knowing that Rico and Kyle are up in that neck of the woods of pavement, you know, making it big, and Kyle's already made it big, and Rico's made it big too, but he's got another track to make it even bigger. But I wouldn't say I'm not satisfied. I'd rather be here than running go-karts still. So I'm just happy with what I'm doing and trying to push as fast as I can and try to get more wing car rides as I'm working on right now and just try to push as fast as I can, but not too fast, because if you push too fast, it kind of might lead you into the wrong direction, some wrong teams you might not want to be involved with.
Yeah, you definitely don't want to rush it, but I think all of us sitting here can say that you've done a pretty admirable job with getting as far as you've gotten right now, Tanner, and I know none of that's possible by yourself. Sponsors
yeah,
and people
you.
To thank, who makes it happen for you and the whole 67 crew?
It's the biggest one is we got to go with David Abreu and Abreu Vineyards. He's had a lot of good things to say about me, and which led me into running for him, and I just can't thank him enough. He's given me a lot of opportunities with this Keith Coons midget, even starting off in the go-karts, and I think it's paying off, and he's still behind me, so that's a good thing. And I can't thank Keith Coons Motorsports enough. The whole team is awesome. You got Chucky, you got Big Al, you got Pete. They're all great people to be involved with, and obviously you got to thank the teammates too. You build a lot of good relationships with your teammates, and it pays off there in the end, I think.
I think it's well on the way to paying off, Tanner, and we definitely appreciate you taking some time to talk with us here on Motorsports Madness. Looking forward to seeing where you're headed. In fact, before we let you go, where are you headed for your next slate of races?
The plan is to run Lernerville in a wing car coming up this weekend. That's the talk, so we're going to race Lernerville Friday and then hopefully shoot over to Peabody, Missouri for that Outlaw/Power Eye co-sanctioned race. So be running the 67 midget there, hopefully, and so that's the plan. And then we'll be heading up to Knoxville to go root on some of my buddies.
The Nationals are a big night, and I know you'll be there supporting a lot of guys. Tanner, again, appreciate you being on, and best of luck going forward the rest of this season. We'll look forward to having you back on.
Yeah, thank you, guys. Thanks for having me.
That's Tanner Thorson, and we're going to stick with the dirt and bring Steve Ovens on to talk some dirt late models and head back to the world of outlaws right after this. You're listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network, the voice of motorsports.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds. Bike ride, go fish, walk in the park, phone call, milkshake, play catch, picnic, fly a kite, tell jokes, laugh, talk, read a story, tell a story, bumper car, swing set, bowling, pillow fight, cut loose, stay tight. Whew. Because the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Media sales professionals with agency experience. If you're frustrated with your current position, unrealistic quotas, and inept management, if you're a sales machine and you simply will not take no as an acceptable reply, if you're looking for a rapidly growing company with unlimited sales potential for commissions in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, if you're searching for a high-tech, forward-looking, laid-back, but extremely professional organization who appreciate your skills and dedication, we have your next opportunity. Scorpion Radio Group is building a sales team of self-starters who are motivated. Your imagination is the only limit here.
Call 717-749-0444 or email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. That's 717-749-0444 and ask for Sue.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
How to deal with someone who says that's so gay. Outsmart them.
This party is, like, so gay. Totally.
Excuse me, but did you ladies know the word gay used to mean happy or excited? Then it became a word used to describe gay people. Then somehow it came to mean dumb or stupid, which is how you just used it, which is not very nice.
Ew, that guy is on the football team and super smart, and he totally hates us now. Totally.
When you say that's so gay, do you realize what you say? Knock it off. Learn more at thinkbeforeyouspeak.com.
Hi, the kids. It's time to get dirty on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness. Here are your hosts, Jacob, Tom, and Kyle, with Turn 5 Live's curator of Casa de Pork Chop, Stephen Oven.
Welcome back to the Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda, Steve-O joining us on the line for this round of getting down and dirty. Hey, Steve, number one, we need some food. You should bring it to the studio. Number two, dirt late models. I have two words for you. After everything that's happened all year long, I can sum up the entire year in dirt late models in two words. Jonathan Davenport.
You know, I saw recently an article, and it may have been the official press release, but they talked about, you know, the new making of the new Million Dollar Man. I mean, how appropriate is that?
Absolutely. I mean, you stop and look at this. $100,000 at the Dirt Late Model Dream, $50,000 over the weekend at the USA Nationals, 16 wins this season alone, 26,000 at the Prairie Dirt Classic. I mean, how much money can this team win? About the only thing that they haven't won is the World 100, and we haven't even run that yet.
Yeah, that's just exactly it. I mean, the races that have, you know, they haven't won or haven't, you know, had that kind of effort at, we haven't even run yet. We haven't even gotten to Knoxville for the late model guys. And,
oh boy.
You know, it's such a great comparison when you take a look at everything that not only Jonathan Davenport's doing this season, but you stack that up against Clanton. I mean, it's hard to say who's having a better year right now. Certainly Davenport's got some big money wins behind his resume so far in 2015, but boy, what a comparison between Clanton and Davenport. I mean, I thought Stuart Friesen was having the best week ever, and then Davenport goes and wins 50 Gs this weekend.
Oh, yeah, and I'm going to go back, actually, Steve, and take a look at the 16 wins that he's got this year. I'm going to go digging through the website this week and try to do the math on exactly how much money he's gotten between those 16 wins all season long. You got to stop. You got to figure it's close to, if not more than, $250,000 at this point. I mean, and this is a kid that's just getting started in the prime of his career. I mean, we're talking about how well he's done this year. I'm looking at how big can this kid go? I mean, could we be talking about Jonathan Davenport being, you know, the next Scott Blomquist or something like that? You know, future Hall of Famer?
Oh, I think so. I mean, and the thing is these guys are pretty young still. I mean, they still got a lot of time left behind the wheel that they could make things happen. And as we start to see guys like Lanigan and Blomquist start to, you know, focus more on their chassis business, I mean, that's an opportunity. I mean, you know, they're still on track, but, you know, this is such an opportunity for guys like Jonathan Davenport to really take his moment in the spotlight. But it's another thing to have that moment in the spotlight and actually perform and put the results up. And that's just what they're doing right now. But could he be the next, you know, quote-unquote guy in the sport? Absolutely. I think they're showing that right now.
It's been a whole lot of fun to watch that team, and I think it's going to be even more fun to see what he can do going forward. You know, for the Outlaw Late Models, they've got a triple header weekend coming up, not this weekend, but next weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. They're at Delaware, Potomac, and Winchester Speedways, and that Delaware track, I think, is the one that I'm most looking forward to. That's a fun little joint, Steve-O. That's one of the few places I think I really want to see the World of Outlaws come to eventually with the sprint cars, because there's just enough room to put on a really good show.
Yeah, and, you know, that wish may come true. You never know. I mean, although the Outlaws are up to about 92 dates on the schedule, so
yeah.
I'm not sure how many more they can squeeze out of there, but you know, as things, you know, as the ebb and flow goes in the sport, and some tracks come in, some tracks go out, you know, that's certainly something that could happen. But, you know, it's good to see that not only the racing is good, the level of competition is good right now. I mean, across all things on dirt right now, it seems like, you know, everybody is on a positive swing. You know, certainly crowds are there. You know, the competitors have been putting on great racing. And even though the competitors are putting on great racing, you still have guys that, you know, at the end of the day, as they say, the cream always rises to the top. And these three divisions, you know, the top in dirt, they are no different. And I couldn't agree with you more there. I think that would be a great race there for the sprints.
Speaking of the sprints, I was looking forward to good racing Friday and Saturday, Steve, up in Canada. And what does Mother Nature decide to do? Rain on the parade. We did not race Friday or Saturday for the Outlaws. Brockville, Ontario got canceled. Autodrome Drummond got canceled, which leads us now to this coming weekend, the Prelude and then the Ironman 55 at Federated Auto Parts Raceway in Peavely. The longest race of the year, and in my opinion, one of the most unpredictable races of the year, because that extra distance means you can never quite know exactly what you're going to get.
No, and it's also, it's not the easiest track to get around either. I mean, it's one thing if your longest race of the season happened to be on a, you know, a Knoxville where you can just blow around the outside or the inside, whatever you wanted to do. But when you put the longest race of the season at a track that's not the easiest to get around, I really think it shows everything: endurance of the equipment, endurance of the driver, and skill level of the driver. It really takes all three of those pieces. You got to put them all together in order to get the win at the Ironman. And I'm with you, Jacob. I think that is one of the most interesting races to catch during the season. And certainly they're going to have all the action covered, and you can catch it live if you want to. But, if you were going to take, you know, if you were going to say, well, maybe we'll spend the money, we'll watch it live tonight, that might be one that you'd want to circle on the calendar.
Oh, I would love to circle it on the calendar. That's a race that's on my bucket list of dirt races to go to, along with the Knoxville Nationals, which is coming up not this coming weekend, but next weekend. And, you know, it's going to be a fun slate of races this weekend at Peavely. You've got the Outlaws, you've got the PowerEye National Midgets, you've got the Dirt Car Modifieds. It's going to be a whole lot of fun. Kerry Madsen's the defending race winner, Steve.
Yeah.
He passed Donnie Schatz last year to do it. Who do you like for this year's running?
Well, Kerry's, you know, being the defending winner, there's a guy that you can look toward. And certainly, you know, you can never look past Donnie Schatz and everything that he has been doing this season. I can't go with Friesen because, well, he won't be there, so... One of the guys on the list kind of gets crossed off there, but a guy who had a good run early at Oshweken the last time they were on track, and a guy that I think, you know, maybe they're starting to get back on track, is Brad Sweet. I think I would look for the big cat out there at Peavely.
Wow, that's a name I haven't heard since about June. That's surprising.
Yeah, but they had speed at Oshweken. I believe he won the dash as well. And, you know, when you can get the speed, and he had to beat Donnie in the dash to do it. and had good speed early in the feature before the Young Bucks come up and stole the show. But, yeah, I think those guys are kind of getting things back on track, and that'd be a guy I'd watch.
How about this being a busy week for the Super Dirt Car Big Block Modifieds real quick, too? They're racing tonight at Merrittville in 100-lapper, headed tomorrow night to your neck of the woods, Steve, going to Ransomville, and then Thursday night they're going to be at Weedsport for the Hall of Fame 100. Does it get any better than this?
Not really. And when you also consider that those tracks are all within, I'll say 3 hours just to be safe, but when you consider that those places are all, you know, within that short distance, race fans are just licking their chops this week for Super Dirt Car Series action. Some folks to keep your eye on at Merrittville. Anytime the cars cross the border, the doctor, Danny Johnson, always seems to find just a little bit extra to please his Canadian fans. And he is a regular at Ransomville as well, so you know, he'll be a threat there to win. But the exciting race last year at Ransomville was Matt Shepard and Justin Harris for a little while. So I would keep my eye on those guys. And when it comes to Weedsport, I put my money on Billy Decker any day.
I would suggest you keep your eyes on the points battle too, Steve. Matt Shepard and Billy Decker are going at it just like they did last year. 3 points separate the two of them with a few races to go.
Yes, and we're starting to get into that late season run where we're going to start getting into some of the biggest races of the season, and it with a close point battle, you can't ask for anything more. We're just, I think this weekend will bring us to just over 2 months before the last Super Dirt Week. Super Dirt Week, 44 years in the making. So we've got drama headed to Syracuse.
Yeah, we really do. 14 races to go, Steve. So Super Dirt Car Series going to heat up. We always appreciate you being on. And race fans, you can catch Steve-O and the gang on Turn 5 Live every Tuesday night at 7:30 p.m. Eastern right here on the Performance Motorsports Network. When we come back, we're going to go totally to the other side of the spectrum and talk Pirelli World Challenge and road racing. You're listening to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network, the voice of motorsport.
Parents, your son or daughter has had their license for a while now, but you want to make sure they're prepared for any situation they may face on the road. High school driver's ed doesn't teach them to drive defensively. They need to be prepared for any highway emergency. For less than a month's insurance, and a whole lot less, BSR instructors at Summit Point Motorsports Park in nearby Summit Point, West Virginia, will teach your son or daughter how to respond instantly and positively to unexpected situations on the road. BSR's specialized accident avoidance training teaches swerve to avoid maneuvers at highway speed, ocular driving, which focuses driving attention on ways to avoid accidents, vehicle dynamics and feedback, skid control and skid recovery, threshold braking on straights and progressive braking on curves, and off-road recovery techniques. This is stuff driver's ed simply doesn't teach. So call BSR today, 304-725-8444. Give your kid the skill set needed to drive safely and responsibly on the highway. That's 304-725-8444.
Do you hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right, it's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
We're growing like crazy and need account reps who know their way around agencies, the internet, and social media. Got connections? Or do you know how to get to the decision makers? Are you fearless? We need you. Internet radio, or as we call it, wireless mobile radio, is rapidly becoming the place to be with almost limitless income potential. So contact us to get involved with the fastest growing professionally produced group of internet radio stations in the world. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or you can email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
Hi, this is John Ondrasik of Five for Fighting, here for RAD, the entertainment industry's voice for road safety. You know, style is a personal thing, and your lifestyle is your business. But if you take it on the road, it becomes everybody's business. So please, plan ahead, designate before you celebrate. Friends, don't let friends drive drunk.
A public service announcement brought to you by RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Time to get back to tonight's Motorsports Madness. Here are the only three of a kind that beats a full house. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
A half hour to go, and we're still going strong. Welcome back to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network, the aforementioned power trio plus one, because Hunter Smith now joins us for Pirelli World Challenge conversation here on Motorsports Madness. And Hunter, we missed you. It's been a month, and in that month, we've gotten to not see a lot of road racing. But before we talk about the road racing that happened over the weekend, you got a win.
Yeah, we did. We took Tobias Slingshot All-Star Series out in Borgers Raceway in Sailorsburg, Pennsylvania. Went and drove for the J&E Motorsports Group. It was a lot of fun and pulled out a win out of it. It was a lot of fun.
We had to throw Hunter his little shameless self-plug in there. So and we're also happy because there's a checkered flag and we love those.
Absolutely.
Oh, geez. You two are on the same mental wavelength. This is going to be a long segment.
Yes.
Anyway, Hunter, another guy that was almost as good as you were in your Slingshot win, or maybe even a little bit better, because this is as many number ones as I've seen in front of his name since, he was running the Rolex Sports Car Series. Where did Ryan Dial come from back out of the woodwork? Swept everything at Mid-Ohio over the weekend.
You know, Dial took two wins at Mid-Ohio last year, and it was kind of where he turned the season around. I think he's doing it again this year. He was consistent enough to stay in the points battle all till this point, but now he takes first in practice qualifying and both wins this weekend, and he takes the points lead in GT now. So he's over Olivier Beretta, who, you know, he wasn't very impressive this weekend. He was second in qualifying, and he finished third in round 14. So not much to shake a stick at for Beretta, but Dial, he could be your new championship guy to look at right now.
Hey, Big Mike, I don't know what buttons you've got back there, but I feel like Ryan Dial deserves a sound effect.
No sound effect for Ryan. Mike is being a sound effect soup Nazi right now.
Aw, that's no fun. No. Anyway, I'll move forward before I get too disappointed. GTA, the guy that I really wanted to see do well this weekend was in a Lamborghini, and Austin Cindric almost obliged me. He took the pole in qualifying, and then when it came to race time, he just didn't quite have the speed that everybody else had. Frank Montecalvo said, "Hi, boys, I'm still here." And, you know, Brian Heitkotter, those are the two names we've talked about all season long in this class. And what do? They split the wins again.
And I'll tell you what, this is the last time that we're going to talk about Brian Heitkotter in GTA competition, because now he's got a GT badge. He will be moving up a class from the rest of the season on. So he's no longer in the GTA points battle. Chalk him up to the GT guys. But yeah, Brian Heitkotter, he took his win in round 15, second in round 14, and was third in qualifying. So Henrik Cisneros is your points leader in GTA, and he really wasn't impressive this weekend. Didn't really take anything to mention. Frank Montecalvo, he moves into second in points now with Heitkotter moving up. And he took the win in 14 and took third in round 15, so he's staying consistent with a lot of podiums. And like you said, Austin Cindric, you know, it was going to be interesting because he's with a good team. He came in with the Blank Pain Racing Lamborghini. And for a debut, you know, I wasn't extremely disappointed, but he took first in qualifying, like you said, and even took second place in round 15. So had a little bit of a mishap in round 14, but stepped it up for 15, and I was a little bit impressed.
Yeah, you know what? This is a kid that will drive anything, anywhere, anytime. That's why we have so much fun talking about him on this show, because you never know where he's going to turn up next, and you know he's going to be fast in whatever he turns up in. So
exactly.
He's fun to watch. I really wanted to see him get the win, especially after his Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge win a couple of weeks ago up in Canada. But as it is, we'll move down the ladder a little bit and go to GTC in just a minute. But really quickly, Hunter, for anybody that's listening that may not be too well-versed in Pirelli World Challenge, I want to clarify a couple of points on Heitkotter moving up. Now, is that a series decision, or is that a decision that he made by himself?
So when you have enough podiums and enough wins and whatnot in GTA, you move up into GT. That basically differentiates the quote-unquote professional drivers from the adequate drivers, which is essentially what the A stands for, amateur. So Brian showed enough to the series, so now he's moving up into GT.
All right. There's Hunter with your dictionary definition of the week in Pirelli World Challenge. GTC, or GT Cup, as they call it. Hunter, I've only said this one other time all season long, but I get to say it tonight. I found somebody capable of beating Colin Thompson.
Yeah, and you know what? I actually thought about this, and I think we're still going to rename this class GTC, but instead of being GT Cup, it's going to be GT Colin. So he still was able to take a win in round 13, and he still finished second in round 12, and he took the pole in qualifying. He got his 10th win of the year. Kelly Moss Motorsports on a roll with him this year. Still a points leader by a long shot. I don't think anyone's going to touch him for the championship. But the Global Motorsports Group with Alec Udell did take the win in round 12. It was Alec's first win. He's been trying for a while. And no one could upset Colin Thompson. But he gets the win in GT Colin. Sloan Urie was also doing pretty good. He was third in practice and third in round 12. So a lot of guys, you know, you would think that the points battle would be kind of crazy, but Colin's running away with it. Sloan and Alec Udell, they're going at it for second place. That's about all I can say.
Yeah, the best of the rest, we'll call it. But no, Colin joked on Instagram after the win in the final round that, hey, I can start counting wins on my toes now because we've got both hands covered.
Exactly. You know, I'm assuming he's going to need his toes, but we'll see what the season holds for the rest of the year.
GTS, the final class that was running at Mid-Ohio this weekend. Keep in mind, all of this was going on as one of the support divisions to the IndyCar race at Mid-Ohio that took place on Sunday. GTS was kind of fun to watch because Chris Wilson and the Aston Martin, fastest in practice, did not take the pole, but took the win when it mattered in the final race for GTS round 12, but hey, look, an American brand went to victory lane in GTS. Michael Cooper wins in a Chevy. I haven't said that all year.
Yeah, it was great to see the Black Dog Speed Shop guys up front. Michael Cooper went to take the win in GTS round 11. He was also second in qualifying. Like you said, too, Chris Wilson, he went to the win in round number 12, and he was fastest in practice. Jack Baldwin was fastest in qualifying. You know, the GTS class has been so competitive this year. We have so many names here that were decent this weekend. You know, Dean Martin, he's up there running for a championship. He was second in round 11 and third in round 12. Andy Lee even stuck his nose in there in another Chevy Camaro, you know, third in practice, third in qualifying. But Andrew Aquilante in his Mustang is still leading the points right now. You know, him and his teammate Kurt Resitano, they're going at it for the championship, but this weekend was not a good weekend for either one of them. Really nothing to shake a stick at for either one.
No, it really wasn't, and it's going to be interesting. I think this is one of the little bit closer points battles than any of the other classes in Pirelli. Speaking of other classes, the touring car classes, that well, they get their crack at Mid-Ohio. Not going to be this weekend, but next weekend, because Pirelli World Challenge will be back, Hunter, at the Mid-Ohio Sports Car Course in tandem with the NASCAR Xfinity Series for the touring car rounds 10, 11, and 12, August 13th through the 15th. We didn't have you on for a month, and now we get to have you three out of the next 4 weeks.
I know, it's going to be crazy. I'm excited for these TC cars to get their crack at it. It's always fun when the TC cars have their own weekend. I mean, I know they'll be with the NASCAR guys, but in my eyes, they have their own weekend. We got a lot of stuff to look forward to as well. You know, Compass 360, one of the biggest things to come out of Pirelli this week. Compass 360, a very well-known name in sports car racing. They announced that their Audi TTRS program will debut at Sonoma with the GTS cars. Paul Holton is going to come to drive the car, and they're going to have some support from Aero Paint. That's going to be a really cool deal for them, this new program that Audi's bringing out. I love Paul Holton. He's a great driver. He's a cool kid. I'm excited to see him get this opportunity with Compass 360 as well.
There's Hunter's news break for the day.
Yes.
Before I let you go real quickly, I want to ask you this because I've been mulling it over since his second win of the weekend. With Ryan Dial taking the reins back in the GT class, are you of the opinion, as I am at this point, that all of a sudden those two wins kind of put him in the driver's seat for the championship now? Because we know this is a driver, we've seen it before in other forms of sports car racing. When he gets on a roll, boy, he gets on a roll.
You know, if Ryan wants the championship, I don't think he has a choice but to get on a roll right now. I know he has to miss the races at Sonoma. in the GT class for prior obligations in other racing series, I believe. But he that's two or three races right there that he's going to miss, and Olivier Beretta is not going to be someone to fall off kilter right away. So if he wants to get this championship, he's really got to start racking up in all the points in the races he's going to be at before Sonoma.
I'm looking forward to seeing how it shakes out, Hunter, and we're looking forward to having you back on 2 weeks from now to wrap up the second half of Mid-Ohio for Pirelli World Challenge. Until then, you know, if you find something else to jump in and try to go run a race in the meantime, go bring us back a checkered flag. We're liking it when you do that.
Oh, I'll do my best. I'll tell you what, in 2 weeks, too, I'm back in Charlotte, so I am so excited to come back down south and be awesome. There for the time being.
We miss you. We want the next 2 weeks to go by in a decent hurry, but we don't want to miss the racing in the meantime, Tom. That's a conundrum, though.
Yes, it is a conundrum, but time goes fast enough as it is. We'll be good to have Hunter back in the South, though.
Yeah, exactly. We'll be. We're looking forward to it. In the meantime, we're going to do some final business, come back with the white flag, talk a little bit of V8 supercars, and then get ready to close the show with our performance picks. Right now, you're listening to Motorsports Madness on PMN, the Performance Motorsports Network.
Motorsports sales professionals. Performance Motorsports is looking to build a team of experienced media sales professionals to represent our programming to the industry's top companies, magazines, and racing series. If you have motorsports sales or marketing experience, know how to work with agencies, understand social media, and are incredibly creative when it comes to working with clients and promotions, then we want to hear from you. Top performers are richly rewarded. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444 or email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
Every 30 minutes, another innocent person is killed due to a drunk driver.
My best friend.
My brother.
My poor grandchild.
My sister.
My father.
My husband.
My mom. My mommy.
Well, I've been afraid of changing, 'cause I've built my life around you.
Stop these tragedies before they happen. Don't drink and drive.
Do you love the sound of high-revving motors and the smell of burning rubber? Do you want to get your car sideways right at the ragged edge of control? If you've always wanted to try drifting or learn to improve your drifting skills, Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier motorsports facility, has the expert instructors and the specialized track to teach you how to drift and the skills necessary to drift competitively. From skid pad to open sessions, Summit Point Motorsports Park has the safe and open environment that allows drifters of all skill levels, new to intermediate, to get sideways and smoking. With a focus on safety and the skill set necessary to drift competitively, Summit Point Motorsports Park's Drift Nirvana is just the thing for you. Call for your reservation today, 304-725-8444. Or for more information, go online, summitpoint-raceway.com, or you can email them at office@bsrinc.com. Drift Nirvana, getting you sideways the right way.
If you own a gun, you have a full-time responsibility. When you aren't using it, be sure it can't get into the hands of curious children, troubled teenagers, a thief, or anyone else who might misuse it. Your family, friends, and neighbors are all counting on you. Remember, always lock it up. For more information on firearm storage safety, visit ncpc.org. This message brought to you by the National Crime Prevention Council, the Bureau of Justice Assistance, and the Ad Council.
We now return you to 2.5 Men on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
So we had a meeting of the minds during the break, and we decided Hunter needed to stick around for performance picks since he's been doing remarkably well lately. So we're going to allow him to do that, and we welcome you back to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda, and Hunter's still here at the roundtable. We got, about 15 or so more minutes to hash through. And Tom, really quickly, I have something to talk about that's about you, but before I do that, V8 supercars were in action, and since our own James Pike is not with us to be able to talk about them, but you and I saw the final race, It's been a Ford kind of year. Mark Winterbottom won both of the short sprint races, but the long race was the one that was a whole lot of fun. A lot of pit strategy, a lot of chaos. And at the end of it all, the 20-year-old kid that Ford has hung all their hopes on going forward, they signed him to a new four-year contract through 2019. Chaz Mostert repaid them with a win in Queensland.
Yeah, now how ironic is it that just when it appeared that Dodge was about to win a cup championship, they won the championship and left NASCAR. And there's been all this conversation about Ford pulling out of V8 supercars, and yet their teams are simply dominant right now. I mean, that's it's really unbelievable to watch what's going on. And that race this weekend, not any different, really. I mean, it was a boring race once it started, to be honest, because basically that group had them covered.
Yeah, they really did. I mean, Chaz was just head and shoulders above everybody, except for Craig Lowndes for a little while, who I was happy to see finish second, but Winterbottom on the podium, almost a 300-point championship lead now. I mean, it's just remarkable what Frosty's done this year in search of that elusive first title. He's trying to get it. We'll look forward to having a taped segment with James coming up here for next week's Motorsports Madness, because he's over in Scotland right now, Mr. Baker.
Yes, he is, and I'm jealous. I've always wanted to go to Scotland and Ireland, and he's going to visit both places. James definitely is our V8 supercar specialist here, and I'm sure he's going to be very, very interested to comment on what's going on right now with the supercars.
He's amped. We love that. And he'll be back here before we know it. In the meantime, gentlemen, we have performance picks, which means we have reverse order. And the guy who picks last is the guy that wins the weekend. And it deserves a special sound effect because Tom Baker is the guy who wins the weekend. Big Mike, hit the button.
That must mean that Halley's Comet is right around the corner, because we all know I only win a weekend once every 76 years.
You've won three of the last four, though. That's the big thing.
I know. It's amazing. The blind squirrel has found some nuts, and I'm on a roll.
You're only 108 points out of the lead now. You've made up almost 150 points in a month.
Yeah, well, you know, the comeback kid, here we go. I mean, I'm stoked about the last part of the season here. We got road course racing this weekend. I'm ready.
We do have road course racing, and to do that, I'll let the road course expert go first. Unfortunately, this was kind of a rough weekend for you, Hunter, even though you were right with Tom and picked Graham Rahal to win the IndyCar race.
That's
didn't
right.
get much else going right besides that. So we've got K&N East, Xfinity, and Cuppers all at the Glen, my friend.
All right, so bear with me a little bit. I am looking at the entry list right now. Okay, so I'm going to start with the bottom. I'm going to go K&N East. I'm going to go way outside the box. You know what? I have no shot at probably a championship in the K&N East points. So I'm going to go way outside the box. I'm going to go Sarah Cornett Ching in the K&N East, just to give her a little publicity. You know, she's been running very kind of consistently in ARCA. She's been showing me a little bit, been following
she's
her a little
been
bit.
She's respectable in ARCA this year.
Yes.
Exactly. So I'm going to go with her for the K&N East race. For the Xfinity race, as much as I really don't want to pick him, I need some wins. I'm going to go with Joey Logano. I'm going to go with him. I'm not a huge fan. I'm saying it now, but I'm going to go with him for rack me up some points in Xfinity. And in Cup, I'd kind of be stupid not to go with him. I spoke actually with my good friend Jeremy Mayfield about this, about who's going to win this weekend. He's been making some picks with me lately. I'm going to go with Kyle Busch. He's been on a roll. I'd be kind of stupid not to pick him. He's won races at Watkins Glen before, and I think he can do it again.
Yep, he went there. He went there. So Kyle Busch, and he took my pick too, which I really hate. But in the meantime, I guess I'll give him that coin only because, yeah, Kyle would be that guy. Kyle Magda, we'll go to another Kyle and say, you, sir, You picked the ARCA race correctly and got Cole Custer. Other than that, you had your worst weekend in about 6 weeks. So you're next.
I did pick
you,
Jeff Gordon.
You gave up the points lead to Aaron Bearden, who missed all of Speed Weeks.
Finished second in the Cup race, so that probably didn't help me. And then with Luca Filippi going off track in the last lap, probably didn't help me either.
Kaboom.
So, all right, picks for this weekend. K&N, I'll tell you what, I've been looking at this entry list, and it's pretty interesting. I did not expect it. I'm not gonna take the obvious pick, so I'm feeling kind of edgy this weekend. Let's go with Brian Wong in the Michael Hillman Racing Chevrolet. You know, he's been a good road ringer, finished second in New Jersey in the ARCA race.
What? Did I just hear you correctly, or do I need my hearing check?
I think you're right. I think you did hear that right. Brian Wong, yes, for the Hillman Racing Chevrolet, number 40. The same team that Austin Dillon drove for at Sonoma. Yes, okay. He's a road course ringer. And then since Hunter picked Joey Logano, I'll take the other Cup guy, Brad Keselowski. Thanks for leaving that out there. And then for the Cup race on Sunday, I've been saving this pick all season long. I picked Dinger last year, and I won, guys. So
me too.
This pick, yeah, and you know, this pick I've been thinking about. I'm going to stick with it. I know I'm second in points right now, but I'm sticking with it. My pick, the 9 of Sam Hornish Jr.
What?
Wow. I think that's farther out of the box than Sarah Cornett Ching.
You'd be better off sticking with the Biff, I tell you what.
Ouch.
Plus fit the Pocono, but no, I mean, last time Sam Hornish ran this race, he was fifth with Penske, and I think the last couple of years he ran the Xfinity race nationwide at the time, he was second or third both years. So, you know, and this team was second last year with Ambrose. They won before, so you know what? The one time I'm going to pick Sam Hornish Jr. all year will be this weekend, Jacob.
Hornish was also, I think, with Gibbs when he finished second in those races.
Yeah, there was that.
Small detail.
I'm just throwing it in there. I know you guys are probably never going to want me to pick online again, but I'm just throwing it in.
It's okay. This is what makes it fun. I'm next, which means we go to K&N East. And you know what? Thank you guys for leaving me the obvious pick.
Oh, you're welcome.
Because this is the breakout weekend, just like it was a year ago. Scott Heckert.
Oh.
Duh. I mean, did we really go two picks into this? And even Kyle, I thought sure you would pick Heckert.
No, I want to be exciting this weekend. So.
Wow. Okay. Anyway. Xfinity, I actually want to look at this and make sure because I'm dreaming, right? There's got to be some other Cup guy that's not Brad Keselowski and Joey Logano, right?
There may be.
I'm going to scan this real quick, but in the meantime, I'll go ahead
and...
I'm not
seeing any.
No, really?
Well, we've got Kyle Larson.
Oh, hey, there we go. That's what I'm going to do. Kyle Larson. Why not? He finished fourth in the Cup race last year after almost being a lap down because he had to serve a pit road penalty. So why not? I'll take Larson on a road course. That sounds fun. And let's see. For the Cup race, Hunter already took my pick for Kyle Busch. What does that leave me? Oh, wait. I know. I'm going to be Tom Baker. If I can't have Kyle Busch, I'll take the guy that won the race last year. AJ Allmendinger puts himself back in the chase with a win at Watkins Glen.
I was so sure you were going to pick Jimmy Johnson. And
oh,
then we could have the boom
Are
confetti sound effect again.
Are you kidding? No way I'm picking Jimmy.
Well, yeah, of course you didn't, because he's not the 2-inch limb this week. That's why.
The only other pick that I was possibly mulling that wasn't AJ was Carl Edwards, because he's sneaky good on road courses. But, you know, that's just one of those where I didn't want to be that guy, Tom. So, Mr. Winner of the Weekend, you're next.
Okay, so K&M Pro Series East, Jacob, I was so sure you were going here. I'm really glad you didn't. You can have Scott Heckert. I'm taking his road course experience teammate, J.J. Haley to get the win at Watkins Glen this weekend. I think this is the weekend he puts it all together and that five car goes to victory lane.
And you know what? If he does, I will never have been more glad to be wrong.
Exactly. I will be proud to be right. In the Xfinity series, I can't believe nobody picked this guy. He's in one of the top cars in the series. Boris said is going to victory lane in the 54 car this weekend.
No, he's not.
Yes,
no,
he is not. It is going to be a said head Saturday at Watkins Glen. He's going to get the win in the 54, and you're all going to have to bow down to me on Monday night. And on Sunday, I am really thankful because I was pretty sure that you were going Carl Edwards, and you didn't, so I will. Carl Edwards gets the win on the road course. I almost picked Dinger anyway, sacrificing any gain I would have on you, Jake, just because I'm really pretty sure he's going to win again. But if he doesn't, Carl Edwards will, and I'm going to throw something else out there. I believe this could well be the week Tony Stewart back in the top five, and wouldn't even be surprised to see him get the win. And I also think Jeff Gordon is going to show very competitively this weekend. I know none of that sounds outrageous from the past success standpoint, but considering the years they both had, I think it is.
Oh, yeah. You know what? And Jeff Gordon finished third, Kyle Magda, at Pocono this weekend.
Yeah,
what? It's about time that the 24 got back on track.
Yeah, and keep in mind, guys, Jeff Gordon had a good car in this race last year until the electrical issue. Actually, I think he was catching Marcus Ambrose until that all went down, and A.J. Allmendinger pit it, and the rest is history. So you guys know what happened there.
Oh, well, there is that. So anyway, before we say goodnight, kids, final thoughts from anybody, Tom? You know, we usually do this little lightning round thing to close the show. Why not?
Sure.
What are you looking forward to?
Well, I'm looking forward to going home this weekend. Unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to get to Watkins Glen, but I'm looking forward to Oswego on Saturday night for their 65th anniversary Super Modified show. Definitely excited about going back to my home track again, the Fast 5/8 of a Mile. And, of course, the night before, I have my 30th anniversary class reunion, so I get two reminders this weekend of how old I am. And then on Sunday, I'll be at the Utica Rome Speedway checking out some of the dirt track action there. So it's going to be a fun weekend and kind of a throwback Thursday kind of weekend for me, and have all the good stuff from those tracks on next Monday's show.
Indeed. Kyle Magda, you and Steve-O are going to be at the Glen this weekend. I'm all pumped up about that, and I imagine that's what you're excited about, sir.
Including a visit to Black Rock Friday night, so woo-hoo! It's going to be an interesting weekend. And guys, I still remember this to this day. I remember my dad saying, we're going to Watkins Glen in 2006. I'm like, are you kidding me? And, you know, I'm about to go to my 10th consecutive year there at the Glen, so it's a good, definitely excited for this weekend. You know, K&N, glad to see K&N back there. From last year, and also Trinity and Cup. So, man, just what a great weekend in road course racing. I love it so much, and I'm looking forward to it this weekend.
Hunter loves road course racing. Is there anything besides the Glen that you're excited about?
I don't really know. You know, it's going to be a couple weeks before I'm back on the show, so I got a couple weeks of excitement coming on. But I feel like I'm coming home, too. But I'm coming home to Charlotte next week, next Thursday, coming back down to North Carolina. We might be racing this Friday. It might be bringing the 30 cart out on Friday night. I'm not sure
nice.
Yet.
You guys racing when I'm not there.
That's always how it works out, isn't it, Magda?
Yeah.
But no, we might be pulling the car out Friday night and going to get one last hurrah in before I head back down to school. But I don't know, just always exciting in the world of racing, that's for sure.
It's not work, it's all fun. We love that. And I'm looking forward to seeing everybody back at the round table here in a couple weeks. The two knuckleheads that are normally here are going to be back here next Monday. Tom, Kyle, Hunter, it's been fun, but we get to throw a checkered flag now. And for these three guys, for Joel Sebastianelli, Steve Ovens, Big Mike behind the glass, and everybody that goes into making this show possible every Monday night here on the Performance Motorsports Network, I'm Jacob Seelman, and I'm saying that if you're going to the racetrack this weekend, keep it off the wall, because we don't need any tore-up race cars. And, you know, for some of us at this round table, we actually will see you at the racetrack. We're back here next Monday night, same time, same place. Until then, have a safe racing weekend. Bye-bye.
You've been listening to Motorsports Madness with the Speed 77 Radio Race Chaser Online crew. Stay tuned to Performance Motorsports Network for more race talk. For the latest motorsports news, visit racechaseronline.com. Motorsports Madness is a copyrighted production of the Performance Motorsports Network. www.performancemotorsportsnetwork.com. A member of the Scorpion Radio Group, Inc. and may not be rebroadcast, replicated, or saved in any media without the explicit written permission of PMN. Check out our Facebook page or our section on the PMN website. The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host, co-host, and guests, and do not necessarily reflect those of the management and ownership of either the Performance Motorsports Network or Scorpion Radio Group Incorporated, the advertisers, or the marketing partners. Be listening again next week when the madness returns on Monday night at 7 Eastern. Until then, keep it off the wall and keep the shiny side up.